Hello, I'm Jorge Lopez. I'm a product manager in the Microsoft Identity Product Group. I will guide you through the configuration of the API-driven provisioning for Microsoft Entra ID Governance. With this API, organizations can use any source of record to provision user data into Microsoft Entra ID in the cloud or even on-premises Active Directory. Let's discuss this scenario in detail. This is where IT teams can import HR data extracts using any automation tool. It could be flat files, CSV files, or even SQL databases. Employee, contractor, and vendor information can be exported into one of these formats, and an automation tool is used to sync this data with enterprise identity directories. With this API-driven inbound provisioning, IT teams can use any automation tool of their choice, for example, PowerShell scripts or Azure Logic Apps, to modernize and simplify this integration. The first step to configure this API-driven provisioning is to configure the applications or the service principles that are going to help you with the provision. For this, we're going to go to the Microsoft Entra Admin Center, click on Applications and Enterprise Applications. From here, we're going to create a new application. And in the search bar, we're going to type API-driven, which is the name of both applications that you need to configure, depending if you want to configure to on-premises AD or Microsoft Entra ID. There are multiple steps that are different with each other, depending on the configuration that you want to do. Let's start with the Microsoft Entra ID one, which is the cloud provisioning. You can give it any name, or you can create multiple apps if you're configuring multiple sources. For this particular example, I'm going to name it IGA POC, so I can know which one is it. So we're going to hit create, and we're going to wait a couple of minutes for the application to be provisioned. Once the application has been created, we're going to go to the provisioning menu. And here, we're going to click on Get Started. The first thing that we need to do is change the provisioning mode to automatic. Once the provisioning mode is set to automatic, you can then check the next thing, which is the mappings. On the mappings capabilities, you're going to see the attributes that the user is going to be provisioning with. One of the main things that I want you to take note is the matching attribute for this scenario. We're using an external ID attribute that comes from our API or a source of records, and we're going to match it with employee ID in Azure Active Directory. You can also set multiple or more attributes than the one that comes out of the box. And the best thing is that we also support different mapping types, like direct, constant, or expression. So you can add as you need. Another setting that you can do is also send email notifications in case of failures. So make sure you do that and make sure that you change the provisioning status to on. Let's save it. Once this has been saved, you're ready to accept calls to this API to start the provisioning. For this, you're going to need the provisioning API endpoint. This endpoint is unique per application. It contains a service principle with the provisioning capabilities and configurations that you need. As you can tell, in the end of this endpoint, there's a bulk upload endpoint, and I'm going to zoom in so you can see it. This is basically the API that you just created, and all of the calls, post commands on HTTP are going to be made to this endpoint. So take note of this. I would like to show you now what is the simplest way that you can test this API and this inbound provisioning for your users, which is the record storer. Remember, this is an API that accepts HTTP post calls. So the best way to test it is through record storer. So let's do that exercise real quick. Once we're here, we just need to make sure that we are signing with a global administrator for this particular test. This is just a test. The next thing we're going to do is grab that endpoint that we created as part of our API-driven application. We expand view technical information, and we copy this API endpoint. And we're going to paste it here. So remember, this is unique per application. What we need to do as well to make sure that we send our payload in the right format is to add that request filter, which is the content type, the value, new application, plus, or forward slash, stream, plus, JSON. We hit add. So we're making sure that we send, or we're telling the API that we're sending this form. On the payload, I'm going to show you something that I already have prepared here. This is how the payload should look like. So this will be the way that your client will send all of these requests to be provisioned. As you can tell, we have things like name, display name, nickname, and all of the different things that are part of the mapping that we created. I want you to pay attention to the name and some of the attributes here, because we're gonna run some commands against this user. So let's take this payload, and we have, by the way, several examples of this and how to convert things like CSV files into this format. So we'll revisit that in future recordings. But we're going to paste this specific payload, and we're going to change the call to post. Once we run it, we're going to get a 202 accepted message. That means that the operation was successful. One of the response headers that you can tell is going to show you the location of the provisioning log. So this is important because this is the job ID of this specific provisioning. We're provisioning only one user in this example, but you can provision multiple users at the same time with the same call using the same payload type. So one of the things that I can show you is we can call this endpoint, more copy, and we can do a hit command against that endpoint. And the response is going to show you the status of that job. So let's verify if the user was created. We're going to go to enter ID and search for the user. And there it is. The user has been created with the properties that we sent. Let me show you what other operations you can do using the same API for the provisioning of the users, because we can not only create the users, we can also modify those users or update them and delete those users if needed. For this, I'm going to take the employee ID. If you remember correctly, this is the matching attribute that we use in our mapping. So we need that to make all of these other calls to update and delete. I want you to take a look at this value of the department, which is Microsoft. We're going to change this department to something different. So let me show you how the payload looks like for those operations. We have all of these JSON formats and examples in our documentation, so you just need to modify accordingly. So we're going to modify the bulk ID as well as the external ID. And now this user department is going to be changed to tour operations. I'm going to save this for future references. Now I'm going to copy this payload. And I'm going to go to my Graph Explorer and paste that payload into the same API. It's the same endpoint. I'm not changing the endpoint. I'm just basically sending another method with another command, with another type of payload, with the attribute that I want to change. So let's start this. Once it's accepted, let's wait for this to refresh so we can see that change. But one of the things that I want to show you in the meantime is that you can actually monitoring all of these logs and all of these jobs through these logs right here. And all of the different operations that we're taking. So you can not only query Graph Explorer, like in the last example, to see the status of that job, you can literally target this or track this with the portal. So let's see if we have updated by now this department for this user. And as you can tell, the department is now changed. So let's use the same example to now modify or delete this user, which is the next operation. With that, I'm going to show you the payload that I already have saved here. I'm going to change the ID just a previous time. It's very similar. The only thing that is, we're not sending any attributes, but the method is delete. I'm going to save it for future references. I'm going to copy that, go back to Java Explorer, run the query, I get the accepted. So now Let's see what happened with this user. Let's actually go back to the user's blade. I'm going to refresh, and the user is gone. So Kathy Jensen no longer exists in the directory.
Let me highlight another thing that we have available for you. If you also want to have like some other type of calls or you want to see more examples, we also have a quick start with Postman, where we put together a collection that has different type of calls that you can do. And of course, the only thing that you have to change is the bulk upload endpoint that you created as part of the variables of the collection. And this also would allow you to test the service principle application that we created before in one of the examples, right? So you can see that the permissions are actually taking place and how the application interacts with the service principal and the endpoint. So if you want to test this out as well, it's available in our documentation. And just to close, I want to show you the endless possibilities that you have with this API. At the end of the day, your organization will have the ability to grab all of these sorts of records from any type of HR system, do a modification in the middle, some sort of middleware to grab those flat files or those CSV files from your HR system, convert them in the middle into a JSON format to make these payload calls to the API. So possibilities are endless, and there are many, many options that you can do these steps in the middle before making the calls to the API. Make sure you check out our documentation for more information. And thank you for watching.